is Dr. Katrina Lantos Swett. She currently serves as chair of the U.S. Commission on International Religious Freedom in Washington, D.C. She also serves as president and chief executive officer of the Lantos Foundation for Human Rights and Justice. In addition, she teaches human rights and American foreign policy at Tufts University. She's taught at the University of Southern Denmark, and she's worked for, at that time, then-Senator Joe Biden as deputy counsel to the Senate Judiciary Committee. We're really delighted to have Dr. Swett with us here today. We invite her to accept the 2013 Ahmadiyya Muslim Humanitarian Award from the president of our community and then to share your remarks to the convention audience.
Well, I want to thank you all for inviting me here today. I can't tell you how honored and humbled, really, I am to receive that beautiful humanitarian award. It means a great deal to me, and I hope I can live up to the high honor that you have so graciously bestowed upon me today. I need to say that I am accepting this award not only on my behalf, but on behalf of my wonderful colleagues at the U.S. Commission on International Religious Freedom. That includes my fellow commissioners, as well as our ABLE staff, all of whom are dedicated to the defense of religious freedom for billions of people around the world. You know, I want to say, before I get to my more formal remarks, that the very moment I crossed the threshold here at your convention center, I felt a tremendous sense of faith and family. There is a wonderful spirit here, and as I sat up here on the podium watching all of you seated there, I was particularly touched by your marvelous young people, these handsome and polite and well-mannered young boys circulating so beautifully through the audience and sharing water. And really, you should be very proud of this young generation of Ahmadiyya men and girls and boys that you are raising up. And I know that they will grow up to carry on the tremendous traditions of your wonderful community. You know, this is just about a year since I had the opportunity to meet some of you at the Rayburn Building in Washington, D.C. At that time, I also had the honor and great privilege of meeting His Holiness. Like so many in attendance, I was touched by his wise words, his keen understanding, and his persistent leadership in the battle for tolerance and understanding, dignity and freedom in our rapidly changing world. And I was equally touched by the profound gratitude that your community displayed toward those in the room, including my USERF colleagues and I, who have chosen to stand faithfully with you in the struggle for liberty and dignity. Today, a year later, we meet again, this time in the capital of the great state of Pennsylvania, at your 65th annual convention. It is very fitting that for the past several years, you have chosen Harrisburg for your convention, particularly just days before our country's annual celebration of independence. Just 2 hours from Harrisburg is the city of Philadelphia, where our Declaration of Independence was signed on that memorable day. And less than an hour south of where we are today is Gettysburg, where 150 years ago, in the days leading up to July 4th, crucial Civil War battles were fought, which determined the direction our nation would take. Philadelphia is where America, through its July 4th declaration, proclaimed that people are born equal and free. Gettysburg is where America, through a terrible and difficult war, finally began treading the path by which those declarations' words would become deeds, leading to a new birth of freedom through the abolition of slavery. And Harrisburg is where we, all of us in this room, reaffirm that America's declaration of freedom is not only for America or for Americans, but for everyone, including the Ahmadiyya Muslims throughout the world. In the decades after the Civil War, America began its astounding rise to power and influence, and by the early 20th century was on its way to world leadership. Around the same time, nearly a century ago, Ahmadiyya Muslims came to this country and have since become a permanent part of America's landscape of liberty. From the very beginning, your community has honored the values of July 4th, reminding us of our need to keep them front and center as we have grown in power and stature. By your words and deeds, you remind us that humanity was not made for war and bloodshed, but for fellowship and peace. You remind us that we should strive to live in harmony with others, and that when conflicts arise, they should be resolved whenever possible by the pen and not the sword. You remind us that with power comes great responsibility, and that as the leader of the free world, we must continue to be, by our example, an inspiration to others who seek freedom too. You remind us that true strength lies in moderation and restraint, not fanaticism and hatred, and that we must choose the high road of tolerance over the low road of bigotry. You remind us that true faith does not demand coercion or inducement by others, but freedom of conscience for all. You remind us that the true test of tolerance is how we treat others when they contend with us on life's most profound questions, including matters of human nature and destiny. And you remind us of your deep and abiding love for your fellow Americans. In the darkest days after 9/11, your community literally gave its blood for our wounded nation, eventually donating over 25,000 life-saving units of blood in memory of those that fell that day. Simply stated, your values equal our values, and your presence has enriched us greatly. Now, I wish I could say that across most of today's world, these values are truly winning the day. I wish I could say that human dignity and worth is being honored and upheld. I wish I could say that sectarian wars are over and that religious persecution is but a dark memory from a distant past. I wish I could say that most governments are truly respecting human rights, including the precious right of religious freedom. I wish I could say that across the world, most people are able to think as they please, believe or not believe as their conscience leads, and peacefully practice their beliefs openly and without intimidation or fear. I wish I could say that any of these statements are true, but sadly, I can't, because they are not. What I am compelled to say is this. Nearly 75% of the world's people live in nations where freedom of religion and related human rights are under siege. That includes millions of members of the Ahmadiyya community, the very community that cares deeply about these rights, not just for its own members, but for every member of humanity. Among the world's most serious offenders is the nation of Pakistan. For nearly four decades, since 1974, the Constitution of Pakistan has labeled all Ahmadiyya non-Muslims. How ironic and absurd this is. You know, I had the opportunity during the drive here from the airport in Baltimore to really be instructed by one of your very impressive young community members about the history and origin of the Ahmadiyya community, and came to understand more fully than I had before that it is you who represents a revival of true Islam and a turning back to the origins of your faith. And so how ironic and really how cruel that in the Constitution of Pakistan, this community of all communities should be labeled as non-Muslims. For more than a quarter of a century, the government of Pakistan has barred the Ahmadi community from calling its own worship centers mosques, from publicly uttering the traditional Islamic greeting, or quoting from the Holy Quran, and from displaying the basic affirmation of Islam. Throughout Pakistan, Ahmadiyya are prohibited from sharing their beliefs with others or publishing and disseminating their own religious material. They are restricted from building houses of worship and holding public gatherings. And since they must register as non-Muslims in order to vote, Ahmadiyya are effectively disenfranchised. Coupled with Pakistan's blasphemy laws, which affect every faith community, these laws have helped foster a climate of intimidation and violence against Ahmadiyya members. But Pakistan isn't the only country which violates freedom of religion for the Ahmadiyya. In Indonesia, since 2008, the government has seriously limited Ahmadiyya activity to private worship and prohibited members from telling others about their faith. Since that time, at least 50 Ahmadiyya mosques have been vandalized and 36 mosques and meeting places shut down. In parts of East and West Java and elsewhere, extremist religious groups press local officials to close places of worship or ban Ahmadiyya activity altogether. In Saudi Arabia, Ahmadiyya members have been deported for their beliefs. In Egypt, they have been charged under its blasphemy laws. In 2010, YouServ's intervention helped a number of members leave Egypt for safety abroad. In Kazakhstan, the government's interpretation of its own religion law has denied the legal legitimacy of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community. Now, let's be clear. The message of the Ahmadiyya community is not ultimately about its own needs, but about humanity's deepest aspirations. Reaching beyond its own predicament, the Ahmadiyya's message is a powerful and eloquent call for world harmony and liberty. Ahmadiyya Muslims want freedom not just for their own personal comfort, but so that others can find freedom and be empowered to serve human needs. We who are in this room, we who believe in peace and freedom, have chosen never to be silent. We have chosen to take a stand for those who face persecution, wherever and whenever it occurs. So the question for all of us today is, what can we do? First, we must realize that the mistreatment of the Ahmadiyya is a barometer for how other people and groups are treated. Simply stated, the same societies that violate the religious freedom of the Ahmadiyya abuse the rights of others as well. As YouServ has documented, where Ahmadiyya suffer, Hindus, Christians, Sikhs, Baha'is, Shia, and other Muslims are persecuted as well. Second, in order to protect the rights of all, including the Ahmadiyya, and foster peaceful, stable societies, we who are in Washington must make religious freedom a truly compelling foreign policy priority, woven into every aspect of our relationships with other countries. Finally, the U.S. government should specifically confront nations which single out the Ahmadiyya for persecution. For example, we must urge Pakistan to amend its constitution and rescind all anti-Ahmadiyya laws. We should urge Indonesia to overturn its 2008 decree and all provincial bans against Ahmadiyya religious practice. We should press both governments to investigate acts of violence thoroughly and prosecute perpetrators vigorously. And until Pakistan proves itself to be serious about reform, YouServ believes that it qualifies as a country of particular concern, our most serious designation for countries that violate religious freedom. Next Thursday, Americans everywhere will honor our founding declaration. we will remember its opening thoughts, that freedoms are not privileges for rulers to bestow or withhold, but fundamental rights ordained by a just and merciful creator, and that no person or government can violate these rights without losing moral authority and legitimacy. As we recall these thoughts, let us continue to stand together for human rights and religious freedom as we affirm liberty as the birthright of all humanity. Thank you so much.